All right, we're going to call to order the October 17th meeting of the West Sacramento City Council, the Redevelopment Successor Agency, and the Financing Authority. We're going to begin tonight, as we do each week, with the Pledge of Allegiance. So I'd like to invite our guests to join the council and staff in the pledge, which tonight's going to be led by Mr. Ernesto Lucero. The council did meet with in closed session this evening to confer with our labor negotiator regarding negotiations with firefighters Local 522. No action was taken. That brings us to our general administration agenda, first with item 1A, which is presentations by the public on matters not on the agenda but within the jurisdiction of the City Council. As is noted on our agenda, this is not a time that we could be having a discussion or take any action on an issue brought up under item 1A, but it does provide an opportunity for a public forum on issues within our jurisdiction. We do ask that anyone wishing to address the Council on this or any other item this evening to please fill out one of the yellow cards that's available at the front door and turn it into the City Clerk. In front of the City Clerk is a timer that we use to assure that everyone has a chance to be heard. And so to that end, we limit all comments on each item to no more than 3 minutes. Also in front of the Clerk is a flip chart that indicates which agenda item we're currently considering. We recognize that for some folks speaking in public and on television can create some anxiety, so we do ask that there not be any applause or boos or catcalls or cheers, and that we maintain a civil discourse in the chambers. And with respect to the request to speak cards, the yellow cards, they need to be turned in prior to the conclusion of the staff report on any item. So, for example, if you think you might be speaking on item 12, we take the cards all the way up to the conclusion of the staff report. Once the council discussion and the public testimony has begun, we don't take additional cards. So if you already know you're here for item 11 or item 15, you can turn a card in any time, but the deadline is at the conclusion of the staff report. All right, with that, we have a couple of requests to speak under item 1A, and the first is by Sharon Kowalski.
Hello. I'd like to talk about the parking along Bright Park. You can hear me? Yep. Okay, right. Okay. What I'd like to say positive about it is, in all my years, this is the most used park I have ever seen, and I'm glad. It's good for our residents. But we have a problem, the residents alongside the park on Todd Hunter. We have a heavy flow of traffic that continue to park throughout the neighborhood with disregard for the residents, especially across the street from the basketball and soccer fields on Todd Hunter. This is a continuous problem for the residents that live on Todd Hunter, who live across from Bright Park. We have had several incidences of people blocking our driveways and even parking on our lawns in front of our properties. And sometimes they actually drive into the driveway. Every single person on the list, I got a list of names here, has given me a story of abuse, and that abuse continues, from last weekend. Many have come here for help, get the usual, call the cops. Unfortunately, after the cop has left, we continue to get the abuse. And also, speeding is a problem. Several people have asked for speed bumps, and I'm not sure of all the excuses that were given why it couldn't have a speed bump, but whatever. We have tried to do some things to stop the parking in front of our driveways. We put trash cans out or cones to block them. They move them. And if we forget to put them out, then we have problems. But they might move them anyway. I have seen them take the cones and move them for their own use, so no one parks too close to them, in either behind or in front of their own vehicle. And another problem is, people make their own space between the cars, or no space. I've seen them do the bumper car. And also, we endure verbal abuse and even threats to our person. What I'd like to propose, and the neighbors, is to have marked permit parking on the street along the side of the houses where the residents are, and let the side of the park have free parking. To increase the loading zone size due to the use of that area, because people will park there and people are unable to load. and maybe add some disabled parking. I've seen disabled people have to unload in the street because people were parked in the loading zone. And give each resident several permits for their guests to hang in their cars while they are parked there. And along with this, have clear signs designating the area for residents and their guests. As a closing statement, I would say, we all pay our fair share in taxes and would like to have a parking spot or two in front of their home, in front of our homes, for our guests and our family during the week, and especially on the weekends. Is it 3 minutes?
Yeah.
We wait for cops. We continually put our lives on hold for them to show up. Many times we don't even bother to call them because after too many calls, they consider us the nuisance.
Ms. Kowalski, I do have to ask you to come to a conclusion.
Oh, I only got like 2 sentences. Okay. I have included pictures. That's good enough.
Okay, I'm gonna. If you submit the pictures to the city clerk, then she'll make sure that we each get copies of all of them. Thank you very much. All right, and the city manager will follow up as typical with these items, and the chief of police is, for good reasons, is intending to meet you outside. Ms. Kowalski, the chief of police is outside, going outside the door to be able to follow up directly with you as well. And we also have some procedures for permit parking as well that they can share with you as well. So thank you. All right, Pat Flint.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, council members. Mr. Mayor, I cannot tell you how very disappointed I am in you. I came to you at the last meeting asking you for your help to stop the petition that was going around for a special school board election. You not only did not listen, you supported it on your Facebook page. You were seen with the petition in your hand gathering signatures. And at candidates night, there was a petition being passed around by a representative from Mike McGowan's office, Supervisor McGowan's office. Not only was she passing it around, she was gathering signatures. This is against the violation, I don't know what ruling, of a nonprofit agency when they're doing nonprofit candidates night. It put them in jeopardy of losing their nonprofit status. All this trouble for a two-year position on the school board at the cost of $100,000 to $200,000 to a school district that is already $1.5 million in debt and has to cut that amount from their budget. It makes me wonder what you and Supervisor McGowan's motives are. Care to elaborate so that the good people of West Sacramento can understand? Thank you.
All right, thank you, Mrs. Flint. Those are all the requests you have under item 1A, so we're going to proceed to item 1B. Are there any council communications, reports, or others this evening?
I do.
Mr. Ledesma.
Thank you. On this past Monday, October 15th, we had a meeting of the Yolo County Habitat Natural Community Conservation Plan, JPA, and we had that in Woodland. On that agenda, we made sure we reviewed with the public the current state of the JPA and its finances, as well as made sure we went through a lengthy discussion about some of the next steps with the Yolo County Habitat JPA, including many outreach meetings, bringing back some items back for this council to consider at some point, as well as organizational issues we need to consider. So again, a lot of information that we shared with the public. In addition, the JPA, as part of its ongoing program, met with the Department of Fish and Game on Tuesday to give them an update on the same status of the organization and some next steps, hoping for their cooperation to try to get a conclusion to the plan at some point and support as we move forward. So that's it. Thank you.
All right. Desmond, did you want to report on the oversight board?
Thank you. Yes, I'm sorry. We did have a meeting on Monday of the West Sacramento Successor Agency Oversight Board. And in that meeting, we approved the housing inventory, I guess it is, for the city of West Sacramento through the redevelopment agency. We had to provide that list to the Department of Finance. And so we went through the review with from the folks who conducted that, and we approved that for the to head to the Department of Finance. So that's it. Thank you.
Mayor Pro Tem Villegas.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. On October 10th, the Sacramento Regional County Sanitation District met a couple items, actually just one main one. We received a presentation on the communications plan that we've embarked on, largely to educate the public on the status of the regional sanitation expansion, as I've been keeping the council abreast of all the changes that are going to come down down our way with regards to expanding the plant to a tertiary treatment. We plan to have a hearing November 14th, in which we will begin to discuss in earnest the increased rates to ratepayers, largely to fund what will be a 10-year capital plan for the expansion of the plant. And then the communications plan that we received a presentation on is largely to educate the public about exactly what this is. I mean, we start talking about, you know, what happens when you flush your toilets, and most folks don't really know what happens after that. And they don't understand that that same water goes right back into the river, and it's used for drinking water right down the road. So this whole idea of educating the public about how we can become better stewards of our water is largely what the communication plan is about. But again, the hearing is scheduled for November 14th. And then on, the Yolo County Transportation District met on October 8th. And the only one item that I wanted to bring to the council, and that is that, as the council knows, we don't have a lot of resources or a lot of funding for transit in Yolo County. And so the resources that we do have, we need to be careful with. And recently, there's been a large number of riders on certain trips in Davis where, because they have an international exchange program, a very robust one, these private companies that use our public transit to transport students to and from schools has had an effect for quite some time on our public transit system. And so what we've asked the director to do is to look into exactly what the impact is, because the public is not able to use these routes to get to and from work and to other areas in certain parts of the community. And so we're now having to expand service, and that expansion is expensive, and that expansion is going to be borne by all the other users of the system. So we've asked that the director look into how to make sure that we are not picking up the cost for what is an expansion for a private company to provide a very useful service, which is, you know, the exchange program, but we don't want to have to bear the cost of that. So that was the one item that I wanted to make sure with the council. That's it.
Mr. Kristoff.
Yeah, very briefly. There will be an issue that this is on West Axafka. There will be an issue that is starting to surface, and it pertains to our budget, and it pertains to how our vendors and our contractors and things are being paid. The true-up process that the state of California has is that everything has to be completed on any of the reaches that are out there before they will make 100% of the payments. They do pay a portion, but at the same time, sometimes it takes a very long time for matters to get fully resolved on any one reach. There may be litigation issues, there may be other kinds of issues that we've gone ahead and done the work, we've done what we're supposed to do, but at the same time, we're trying to work out an arrangement with especially the large contractors that we deal with, so that we don't really get too far behind in our payments. But I think it's an issue that, you know, the council needs to be aware of, and I know that staff and the West Axafka board talked a little bit about it, and we're trying to come up with a formula, trying to make it and try to bring something that is clear, concise, and really sort of workable with all of the contractors that we do deal with. And I'll keep the board apprised, I'll keep the council apprised of any of the other issues that, that may come up because of that, because it could put us in a situation where we're late on a payment, and we haven't been late on any of the payments or anything, but we certainly don't want to go down that road. Thank you.
All right, I have a couple items. I was in Washington, D.C. for the Mayor's Water Council 2 weeks ago. The Mayor's Water Council is a standing subunit of the U.S. Conference of Mayors in partnership with a bunch of environmental and water industry folks to try to focus policy attention and best practices work on a variety of water issues. So I was leading a session there on flood protection and trying to, well, the council will recall we've, the U.S. Conference of Mayors, we adopted a series of policy positions on flood protection issues, FEMA issues, that are 1,000% in line with what we're doing here in West Sacramento and what our agenda is. And so I was at the Water Council largely to remind the other mayors of what it is that we're trying to accomplish collectively nationally, but also to build a coalition of some other key cities. I've been working a lot with Des Moines and with Dallas and Baltimore and a couple of others. But to, what I want to do is get a national sign-on letter from the cities of the country that are larger than 250,000 people, plus us, to the White House, to the President on this issue, as well as to the Assistant Secretary of the Army. So it was a very good session. There was a broad interest in participating in a much stronger, much more elevated advocacy effort on the work, both on the FEMA issues with respect to the zones and the mapping and the color of money stuff, so all the FEMA stuff, as well as the crediting question, which has become a problem in lots of other cities across the country as well. So it was very, very useful. The vice mayor of Beijing was at the meeting and said that he had understood that that we were the leading flood protection municipality in the country on flood policy, that we were the leading municipality in the United States.
He heard me.
Must have listened into one of your West Africa meetings on the internet. but that was actually reinforced by several of the other mayors in the city. And so it's a testament to the work that's been going on for a while. But we have definitely had a strong presence and influence there. Immediately after that, I did go to the Capitol Hill to meet with Senator Boxer and Senator Feinstein's office, because earlier in that week, I think it was, that we got the letter from the Assistant Secretary of the Army, who has responsibility for the Army Corps of Engineers, Joel and Darcy, rejecting our waiver request for the crediting that we depend on, that we need for the progress on the levy program. And they were surprised, because I think both Senator Foxer and Senator Feinstein, who've been personally deeply engaged in this, talked to the Assistant Secretary directly about it. I've watched them on TV on appropriations hearings quiz her about the issue. They believe that they had an understanding with her, because she has said, and so has her team repeatedly, that the withdrawal of the crediting provision was not intended to affect us, that we are a model for how it's supposed to work in terms of our financing and our planning, that we've been collaborating with the Corps, and that if we would just submit a waiver request, then all would be good. We submitted the waiver request, and it was rejected. And so we are it is going to be time now to turn up the volume beyond simply trying to persuade her. And so we're working with our advocate in D.C. and with the offices of both Senator Feinstein and Senator Boxer and Congresswoman Matsui around the possibility of language for the next Water Resources Development Act, which Senator Boxer was in the Capitol that day working on a draft. Whether or not this is the season for passage of a new WERDA or not, I think is an open question. But the next WERDA, and if that's not feasible, then a potential rider on an appropriations bill. So upping the game on it. There's also, I think, a broad expectation in D.C. that the Assistant Secretary of the Army is unlikely to be the Assistant Secretary of Army for a lot longer. And so thinking about what the strategy also is for confirmation hearings and what have you for the next round. So that was productive. Also on the water question, Mr. Kristof and I met as part of our informal, unauthorized 2x2 with the City Council of Davis on the potential of West Sacramento being the intermediary for providing for treating the water that Davis would like to take from the Sacramento River for their long-term water supply. I think the council knows the city manager had responded to an outline of a proposal from the city of Davis with some sort of our specific issues with why that probably wouldn't work. And honestly, we hadn't, Mr. Kristoff and I hadn't been particularly rushing to meet because it seemed like we were quite far apart. So the 2x2 from their city council really did really wanted to meet. So we did. We had a good conversation last week here in our city hall and laid out the basic economics that are at stake. We had tried to convey earlier in the week that we were interested in doing this as a basic business proposition, and because we're trying to help Davis, there was nobody on the council that was dying to, you know, this was not like a cash cow for the city of West Sacramento. We'd like to help, but it was clear from a lot of the communications inside the Davis community and in the Davis media that there were a lot of people who seemed to think that they were being wooed by us and by Woodland, and that they could choose between these suitors. And we tried to disabuse them of that notion that while we're happy to help, we're not here to beg. And so we laid out the basic economics of what would make sense on a long-term basis. That was their principal issue, was assuring that they had a long-term supply that was guaranteed, which we would understand because we would want the same thing. So we talked about economically how that would have to work in order to assure that a plant could be expanded and at what cost and whose responsibility and all of that. So we left with, I think, a clearer understanding of what the basic bottom lines were for the two communities, and then left it to them to determine whether or not and if there were any next steps to be taken, but that we were essentially going to not be working on this any further at the policy level or doing any staff work on it unless they express some interest in proceeding and want to do that. My understanding, I think the city manager can confirm, but from the response that they've gotten from their own council and community since then is, it's unlikely to be a road they want to go down, but that has changed every 48 hours. So stay tuned. But we're not working on anything. We're not expecting a counter proposal or something of that nature. And then finally today, the city manager and I and Supervisor McGowan met with the Department of Finance on the redevelopment issue with respect to the Bridge District in particular. We are expecting the Department of Finance's review of our ROPs to be completed and transmitted to us no later than Sunday, which is the deadline. We're working desperately to try to assure that they agree with our position on the Bridge District Development Agreement and Commitment of Property Tax Increment. It was a good meeting. I think there's interest in helping, but we're dealing with Mr. Mitchell. We're dealing with a bunch of attorneys who are not seeing the big picture here or really a lot of basic common sense, or even stuff about, you know, some obvious stuff about the law. So we'll see how that goes. Certainly by Monday we will know one way or the other, and then we'll have to make a determination about what steps we take if it's not a favorable decision. All right, item 1C is appointments to boards and commissions, and just again, we're not making any appointments prior to the general election since they would only be lasting for the next couple of weeks. So we're going to proceed to presentations. Item 2, which is presentation of the 25th anniversary video contest winners. And Mr. Lucero is going to do the lead off.
Good evening. With the continued celebration of our 25th anniversary, tonight we'd like to honor and congratulate the winners of the 25th anniversary video contest, the first video contest that we've organized. And we proved it was a great way to get the community excited about the 25th anniversary, hear from people, hear their stories about why they enjoy living, working, or playing in West Sacramento. Contestants submitted a short 3-minute video on the categories of living, working, and playing, and the winners of the contest are here to receive recognition. So we'll go ahead and first call up each contestant each winner and let them receive their award. We'll take a picture and then we'll do a group photo at the very end. So under the living in West Sacramento, we have Peggy Bell, and her video was called Cheers to 25 Years of Greatness.
Oh, City, if you can tell.
Okay. It's been a pleasure being a citizen here of West Sacramento, and I just am just tickled pink and that I have such a wonderful council that has created such a wonderful space for me to raise my child in, who's not here, darn it.
Thanks, Peggy.
Thank you very much.
So this is our presentation for the certificate, and then here is our prize.
Thank you.
Thank you so much for the submittal and for your great pride in West
thank
Sacramento.
Thank you so much, and thank you guys.
And one moment, please.
Oh, sorry.
Together here, shaking hands.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Great.
Ruth Pagano, a wonderland. She's not able to attend, but we'd still like to congratulate her. Plain West Sacramento, Nate Eckler with the Sea Scouts. Was anybody else from the Sea Scouts here to receive the award? Okay. They did an award. They did a video, How We Play in West Sacramento. All these videos are on the YouTube channel, the West Sacramento YouTube channel, and also on the website. Kathleen Poe. Is she here?
Family production.
It was. For sure.
All right, so here, this is a video that tells doesn't tell a story, but the family goes around the community and playing, enjoying the place, various locations within the community. It's a fun video and also connects the sense of people to to the various amenities in the community. So it was a great one. Congratulations.
Thank you.
To Kathleen.
And then the last one is the grand prize winner. This was Wicked West Pizza and Barbecue. And we have several employees from the restaurant. And the owner, Michelle Van de Heekamp, is also here as well. And their video, Take My Order Maybe. And we're actually going to show it as after.
Crazy, I'm in line, take my order maybe, before you open
hard to wait. It's wicked, baby. I'll be patient. Take my order, maybe. Hey, I just got here. It's wicked, baby. I'm standing line. Take my order, maybe. Go to other spots, you must be crazy. I'm in line. Take my order, maybe. Before we opened our doors, the staff was so sad. The staff was so sad. The staff was so, so sad. And then we opened our doors, the staff was so glad. The staff was so glad. The staff was so, so glad.
All right, the Wicked West team. Everyone else is working, of course. So I was. I mean, for those who don't, who haven't journeyed to Jefferson and Linden, Wicked West is a terrific local establishment. I was there last night eating, so was Mr. Villegas, both for the quality of its food, and its commitment to organic, healthy foods that are also not just kid-friendly, but kid-enjoyable. It's a great place for the whole family to hang out. It's a great place in the community for young people to get a start working and to learn career skills and what it means to work for an impossible boss. And and so they're just a tremendous I'd be remiss if I didn't mention that Wicked West is the sponsor of extended hours and days at the West Sacramento Recreation Center pool this year, which was a big community demand, and Wicked West stepped up to make that happen. So we're really proud of the business and the whole family of people that works to make it happen. So congratulations to all of you on the great video and your submission and your pride in West Sacramento. And the grand prize, as you know, is an iPad 2. You can work it all out later, really.
Come right over here.
Come over here.
It is.
iPad 5.
Mayor in the center. Very good. Looking good. Want to see everybody's faces. Now tighten up a little bit, please. Great, great. Okay, look this way. One, two, three. One more time. Thank you.
And then Art Schroeder would just like to take a picture with all the winners up here front.
All the winners up front, council members, please come down. Group shot.
This is 8:00.
And all of our video winners, please. Right in here. City council members. Let's take a step back toward the corner of the room. Okay, now our winners, please fill in. Want a representative for each of the winners. Here we go, please come up. All right, the whole team, come right up. Now. First of all, let's tighten up a bit. We have some room. Let me just get somebody on the other end here next to Council Member Oscar Villegas. Okay. All right, I want to see everybody's faces. Good. I'm going to take two. Hang in there. One. One. Two. Three. One more time. Take a breath. Relax. One. Two. Three. Great. Thank you.
Well, we're reassembling. I was chuckling. We have one or two folks here from Davis this evening who are wondering why we take so long on these presentations, but I will guarantee that we have not gone past 10:30 more than once in 10 years. So we'd rather have we'd rather recognize some folks early on, but make sure everyone gets home in time to finish their homework and get up and get up in the morning for work. So, all right, item three then is a proclamation honoring October 24th as West Sacramento Food Day. Is there a motion on the proclamation?
Second.
It's been moved by Mayor Pro Tem Villegas and seconded by Mr. Kristoff. Seeing no discussion, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, that motion carries. The proclamation is adopted. We're not making a presentation on that this evening, but it will be transmitted separately. Then item four is a presentation from Christine Crawford, Executive Officer for the Yolo County Local Area Formation Commission, on the Yolo Shared Services Program. Just a reminder, this is an item for presentation only. We're not contemplating any action this evening, but it's an update on the status of the shared services work in which we have been engaged. Ms. Crawford.
Push the button, it'll raise.
Yeah, they don't do that in Davis, I'll tell you that right now.
I can assure you in all the presentations I've given, no other city does this, but most of them do dig Davis's city council for running so late, so we've heard that before. Thank you. Good evening, Mayor Cabalda and members of the council. I'm Christine Crawford, as you know, your executive officer for LAFCO. I've been on board with LAFCO since December of 2011, and I'm very pleased to be here tonight to present to you the shared services work that we've been working on with your program. I wanted to note specifically, although I'm here giving the presentation, this has very much been a collaborative effort among all the city managers and the county administrative officer. We've been working in partnership on the shared services program. As you, as noted in the staff report that Ms. Richardson put together, LAFCO was asked to take over the shared services program to provide a more consistent driving effort towards that program. While my PowerPoint presentation is teeing up, I just wanted to note that I'm going to be condensing a little bit the presentation that I've done for the other city councils. This is actually the final presentation of the LAFCO Roadshow, as it's been termed. We've been going around to all the city councils and the County Board of Supervisors as well, providing this update to everyone. And because a staff report was put together in an essence of time, I'm going to be condensing this a little bit. So if there's any area where you'd like us to go a little bit deeper, please let me know. And go again and again and again. So we've been working on shared services for the county. There's a number of opportunity areas that we've been exploring, but the one that rose to the top very quickly was animal services. As you know, the costs have been escalating and there have been a lot of concerns with the services and the rising cost of this program. So this was one of the first priorities identified for me by the city managers group. And so on behalf of all the cities in the county, LAFCO contracted for a study to review animal services to look at two fundamental questions. You can roll again. The study was to look at two questions. Is there a better model that can provide services better and or reduce costs? And also to look if there's any improvements to the existing system that can be made. Up on the screen, we've provided just a relative cost. These are the fundings coming from all the agencies to provide for the animal services program that the sheriff is currently providing. just so you can get a relative sense of where the funding is coming from for this service. At the bottom, we also noted the SPCA funding that's going in. There's a significant volunteer contribution coming from the SPCA to support the sheriff's services for animal services as well. Let me go again. I have with us tonight the two consultants, Sue Marks Gibbs and Tammy Morrell here, who prepared the study. And typically they've been presenting the findings, but in the essence of time, I was going to run through it very quickly. They're here available to answer any questions that you may have. Basically, the study found that the sheriff's office is doing a good job with the minimal resources that they have. And that service is, they don't have as many resources that it's really necessary to provide a high quality service to the community. There are improvements that can be made to the existing system, but really some of the fundamental issues is that the existing system is not really sustainable. They really need more services to provide, more funding to provide the services needed for a good program for the county. To that end, a JPA model was recommended because really essentially the overhead costs for the sheriff's department are significantly higher than what could be achieved under a JPA model. And so I'm going to provide a little bit more detail on that, but there's a number of advantages with potentially looking at transitioning the service to a JPA. Next, please. These is a list of some of the improvements they're identified that could be made to the existing service. Primarily, if hiring a licensing unit could really help increase revenues. If there was a more aggressive unit out there, specifically targeting and raising funds in this area, there could be a significant additional revenue stream that's not being currently tapped. More spay-neuter programs helps cut down the population, which cuts down the cost of the program over the long term. Outreach and education is a very important component, and an education director is recommended, a volunteer coordinator to help coordinate on the volunteer potential that's out there would be very helpful as well. A new shelter is also needed, and then another concept that's identified is problem-oriented policing, which a lot of us are familiar with in the policing and sheriff and law enforcement portions of programs, but often animal services are left out of this educational process and these priorities. Essentially, I think the upshot of it is you know, the law enforcement, with the animal services currently being under the sheriff's department, you know, the law enforcement, as it should, is the primary, you know, agenda and the priority for the sheriff's office, and animal services doesn't get the attention that it really needs and deserves. Next, please. So a JPA is recommended for a number of reasons. Collaborative decision making, more flexibility to change fees as needed, more flexibility with decision making, attracting more donations, volunteer bases, and as I talked about a little bit earlier, reducing overhead costs, which is a huge factor, and just separating the inherent public safety competition when you have a law enforcement and animal services housed in the same agency. Next, please. This is a quick budget comparison that just shows a snapshot of comparing the existing sheriff's budget that was adopted back in June and what a full service JPA staffing scenario could look like, and just a quick snapshot, and as you can see, it shows that basically, you know, with the existing sheriff's budget, 18 FTE are currently funded, and under a JPA with relatively the same costs, approximately 31 employees is potentially feasible for not a significant increase in cost to each agency. Next, please. So with the recommendation of looking at a JPA, the YOLA Managers Group has been looking at this very seriously. And as you mentioned earlier this evening, you know, there have been oversight and management issues with some of the JPAs that have already been formed. And so, you know, we are very sensitive to the concerns that come with creating yet another JPA in the county. And so the managers group has really been working hard to try and address those issues head on and create a new, different model of a JPA that could address structurally some of those issues, create a two-tiered oversight system that's got a policy board of directors plus a staff level, operations directors level, to really help enhance the oversight and the coordination, the communication. And one thing that, you know, looking at kind of an overarching JPA, where it's contemplated that the first division might be animal services, but other divisions could be added on as new shared services come online. In addition, it would provide an overall framework where we could look at consolidating some of the existing JPAs and possibly fold them into this umbrella structure, reduce the number of JPA boards that you all have to sit on, increase the communication, increase the oversight, because we're kind of funneling some of these services through one JPA as opposed to a multiple of JPAs. That in and of itself, you know, hopefully would be a good thing and add some stability and oversight to some existing problems that are out there. In addition, consolidating JPAs is a shared service cost saver in and of itself, because you reduce the number of executive directors that you have to pay for, and could possibly consolidate some of that under maybe one general manager. So right now, staff is working on preparing draft JPA language that's circulating among the city attorneys and the county council's office right now. It's been reviewed by all the city managers. The way it's currently drafted, it would also be contemplated to include other agencies in the future, perhaps UC Davis, perhaps the tribe, school districts, basically any public agency out there that would benefit from being part of a shared service program. Next, please. As I mentioned before, we're looking at it really to consolidate some of the existing JPAs and provide improved oversight. I think I've already spoke to the slide, so you can move ahead. With that, I'll close. I'm available to answer any questions. You know, your city manager, Mr. Tuttle, has been involved in all these conversations as well and can help, you know, fill in the blanks. I also have the animal consultants here and are available. Thank you.
Right, and what are the next steps?
Oh, sorry. The next steps, after we give this series of presentations, we're going to continue to work on the shared services draft agreement, and then we plan to come back to all the councils and the Board of Supervisors again to actually, you know, potentially look at considering an actual JPA.
Questions? Martha, why don't we go? We have a few requests to speak, so let's go to those, and then we'll return if there are additional questions after that point. So we have five requests to speak on this item. The first is by Lori Lubin. And she will be followed by Evelyn Dale. So there's a button near your right hand.
Yes.
That will, if you click the bottom part of that button, it should.
Oh, nice.
Magic.
Okay, can you hear me? Good evening, Council. I'm a 10-year resident of Yolo County and a former long-term volunteer at the Yolo County Animal Services. I've advocated for many years, along with many people here, for real reform in animal services because of their history of poor performance, poor record keeping, and poor value. Using publicly available data, our group has compiled the performance trend in a figure that I sent to the council yesterday. The figure shows that the animal services budget has, in fact, increased from less than $1 million in 2001 to over $1.8 million in this fiscal year, with a peak budget of $2.2 million in 2007. During this period, the live release rate has remained essentially constant at 50%, with no correlation between the budget and the performance. So despite these budget increases, lower intake numbers by almost 30% over that period, and about half full empty kennels, the current management has been unable to make any significant improvements to the live release rate, which is arguably the only measure of success in animal services. This is not an issue of pet overpopulation. In our community, only about 2,000 animals are euthanized per year in the shelter for a population of 200,000 people in Yolo County. The data also show that the shelter is not really in the adoption business. The outcomes for animals remaining at the shelter are incredibly poor, with adoption rates of only about 20%. Unless the animal is reunited with its owner or transferred to another rescue or shelter, its chance of survival there is quite slim. In addition, you may notice that there are discrepancies of more than 10% or over 500 animals per year between the intake and outcome numbers that you receive in your yearly data. This lack of accurate record keeping is yet another example of poor performance and affects the city's costs, as the numbers that are assigned to the city of West Sac are associated with your billing costs. I think this poor performance really shows that we cannot continue any longer with the current model. The main recommendation of the LAFCO report provides a clear path to achieve a cost-effective shelter. Through the proposed privatization, where animal services and welfare will finally be the number one priority, we can get much-needed programs, more staffing, more volunteers, better enforcement of the current animal control laws, and better outcomes at no additional cost to the city. Thank you.
Thank you. Evelyn Dale will be followed by Janet Cravosa.
Push this to lower it. The whole thing moves. That's pretty cool. Okay, good evening.
No, the rest of the building is moving up.
Perfect. My name is Evelyn Dale. I have lived in Yolo County since 1980, have adopted a good number of family pets from Yolo County Animal Services, and volunteered there from 2007 to 2010. I currently volunteer at the City of Sacramento Animal Care Services on Front Street. I also write a monthly column encouraging responsible pet ownership and the adoption of shelter animals for the Davis Enterprise, and am founding member of the Yolo County Pet Animal Welfare Society, known as YCPAWS, and the Yolo Coalition for Animal Shelter Reform. I'm going to give you just a little bit of history. Back in 2010, we had a countywide meeting here in November to discuss the Yolo County animal welfare issues, and that was sponsored by Helen Thompson, who was at that time a Yolo County supervisor. Based on these discussions, she put together an action plan that was presented to the Board of Supervisors, and it was accepted on the 14th of December of 2010. In August of 2011, YCPAWS asked UC Davis Graduate School of Management to do an objective analysis of Yolo County Animal Services. In April of this year, LEFCO did a similar study. Both of these studies conclude that moving animal services into a joint powers authority or contracting with a nonprofit humane society would better serve our community and its pets, and without really increasing costs to the taxpayers. When LAFCO's Yolo County Animal Services study was made public this August, the Yolo Coalition for Animal Shelter Reform began gathering information and signatures. This petition reads as follows. We are Yolo County residents. We care about our shelter animals. We urge our County Board of Supervisors and City Council to establish an agency, a joint powers authority, or contract with a humane society to run our county animal services and ensure a 90% live release rate. More than 50 communities across the U.S. are doing this. We can too. At this point, 1,753 concerned residents of West Sacramento, Woodland, Davis, Winters, and the unincorporated areas of Yolo County have signed this petition. Today, about one in two animals, as Lori Lubin has said, entering Yolo County's animal shelter are euthanized. This high euthanasia rate has remained sadly consistent over the past decade, regardless of the size of the budget. In short, throwing money at the problem hasn't worked. So what are the chances of making significant improvements to animal services in Yolo County? More than 50 communities across the United States, including open admission shelters, have been managing to achieve live release rates of better than 90%.
Dale,
with the right leadership.
Dale, I need to ask you to come to a conclusion.
Yes, I am. With the right leadership, meaning you people, implementation of proven programs, and a commitment to our city and county officials, we can do it. Thank you very
much. Thank you. All right, Janet Cravosa, who will be followed by Melissa Arnold.
Good evening. I wanted to comment that in the budget, the snapshot of the budget that you saw, that although it does not represent a great increase or any increase over what is currently being spent, it does not take into account what could be achieved through fundraising, private fundraising, if this plan were to go forward and the shelter were to be privatized. I think it's a tremendous opportunity to raise money and to offset some of the expenses and to make it an even more welcoming, attractive, and efficient animal shelter. I also think I professionally have been a fundraiser for about 25 years, and so I've been immersed in in philanthropy for over two decades. And I think this would be an incredibly exciting opportunity, not only for foundations that exist to support animal shelters like the Pet Support Foundation or Maddie's Fund, but also for individuals who live in our community and care very passionately about this situation. Thank you.
Thank you, Melissa Arnold. Followed by Amy McGuire.
Good evening. As a West Sacramento resident and animal lover, I was appalled when I learned that the current live release rates for Yolo County Animal Shelter is 55%. I feel that is unacceptable, and I'm aware of other models that create conditions where more animals find good homes and less animals face euthanasia as a final answer. I know we can do better. I believe in this instance, the way to create a better system for our shelter animals is to completely change the current one. I strongly support the recommendation of the Animal Protection League, and I strongly urge my city council to adopt these recommendations as well. Thank you.
Thank you. And Amy McGuire.
Good evening. As a proud West Sacramentan, I became involved with the movement to bring reform to the animal shelter for two reasons. First, I am an animal lover. I have two dogs and two cats that needed a good home. Second, this issue has allowed me to ask and to answer, what kind of community do I want to live in? That may seem like a simple question, but as we go about our busy lives, we tend to forget that we have community responsibilities. Or we think we can't make change, or we put it off because we think someone else might do it. This issue has forced me to look at my community, West Sacramento, and to take some responsibility for making it the best place it can be. West Sacramento is responsible for the second highest animal intake at the shelter. The adoption of the JPA will have resounding positive effects for my community. First, we will be on the path to having a shelter that we can be proud of, where we can volunteer and support with our pocketbooks. Second, with new shelter leadership and commitment to education on all aspects of pet ownership, West Sacramento will reap the benefits of learning and hopefully embracing the responsibility of being good pet owners and all that that means. Lastly, because I am talking to and engaging my community around this issue, adoption of the JPA recommendations will confirm that West Sacramentans have a voice. They can make change. They can better their community and create an institution that truly reflects the best that our community has to offer. This is the community I want to live in, and that is why I urge all of you to adopt the recommendations of the Animal Protection League's report. There are quite a few people here this evening in support of these recommendations. Most of them, well, I'm the last one, so they will not be speaking. So with your permission, may I ask them to stand? All of you in support of the recommendation? Thank you.
Thank you. All right, so we're going to return to the council now for further questions or discussion. Mr. Johannesson.
Ms. Crawford. When you're looking at forming a JPA, are you also looking at how the existing facilities can be used? I would imagine that would be part of the conversation as well.
We haven't gotten to the part of analyzing the facilities that we have right now. I mean, we're focused right now on looking at the JPA agreement. The reality is that right now we're, should we transition to a JPA, we're going to have to be housed in the existing facilities until, funding is able to be put together for a new shelter.
Right. I know it was maybe a year or so ago we had some folks from Reno that made a presentation here as well. Models like that, I think, would be really beneficial. I think they had a very high rate of lack of euthanasia in the facilities. A lot of it was education, spay and neuter clinics, reducing the population before it comes in, educating people on cat colonies and things like that. So I think there looks like there's going to be a lot of room to improve that if we can organize that.
Right, so we've had extensive conversations with this with the other mayors of the county about this issue as well, and I know there's been a lot of interest in accelerating work on this, and so the YOLO leaders group and others have as well, and I know members of the council have in a variety of ways. I mean, this is not even a workshop format; it's just the presentation at this stage. But I'll give a little bit of feedback. I think the direction that we're headed is the correct one in general. I do want to flag a few issues. The first is, and the most fundamental one, is the JPA itself. I've yet to be convinced about the JPA model for a variety of reasons. A multifunction JPA is a technocracy dream. The notion that what is really the fundamental thing that a government agency does is multiple functions for various governments really does not provide for a great deal of transparency to the public. If you hire an executive director whose job is just to run anything that's multi-jurisdictional, you're not going to get executive directors necessarily that have the expertise not just to be knowledgeable about their subject but to lead. In our county, for example, we have one of the finest what used to be a transit JPA is now a transit agency, but he is one of the country's best rural and small city transit leaders in the country. That's not the person you would get if you had a multifunction JPA. And so we need to be very conscious around sort of the organizational management philosophy in thinking about what a JPA does. The immediate opportunities are for sharing, but sharing itself is not the public objective. And sharing itself is not what we need to be transparent about. It's the actual delivery of services and outcomes for whatever the services might be that really matter to the public and to us. I mean, even on our own council, Mr. Kristoff is a flood and water specialist, and so when we have a JPA that deals with flood and water, we send Mr. Kristoff and sometimes Mr. Ledesma, we send one that deals with transportation, Mr. Villegas and Mr. Johannesson have gone. We have our own abilities to specialize. If we had to pick one of us to go to a JPA whose responsibility was sort of everything else, miscellaneous topics, you don't get the same level of public engagement or elected official oversight. And so we need to be, I don't know what the answer is, and it's not an argument against a JPA, but we need to be, the JPA is more than a management level solution. It has to have a democratic legitimacy to it, and it needs to be focused around not just managing for adequacy, but to be in some of these domains to be the best and to be innovative and to be on the leading edge, and it's very hard to do that when it's one of several things that are completely unrelated that you're doing. So I think, to me, the JPA is one of the key issues about how that's structured in a way that's intentional about policy, democratic policy control of the JPA more than simply as a management entity. So that's one. Second is cost. It isn't enough to not have cost increase. The amount of money that is available to be spent on a third grader in elementary school is declined, absolutely. The amount of money we have to keep a pool open has declined, absolutely. The amount of money that we can spend on fire protection has declined, absolutely. The reason why this is a problem, the animal services is a problem, is because it's gotten so out of control, and it's been going up and up and up as everything else has had to be cut. Animal control services must also bear the same responsibility for the fiscal situation as everything else. And so as we look at these issues, I want to make sure that we're not saying, assume that we just keep the budget that we have today, which has been going up out of proportion to the rest of spending by municipalities in this county. Assume we have that much money, now let's spend it. We need to really hone in on what is critical. That connects back to this JPA question in some respects, because I know Christine's heard me talk about this before, but there are different personalities to the jurisdictions in the cities. We haven't only been frustrated by JPA performance because of management issues, but also because we do sometimes take fundamentally different perspectives. Not radically different in the sense that we are opposing one another, but different priorities generate different outcomes. And even our language, our budget is for animal control. All right, and most of what we've heard tonight is about animal welfare and animal services. The perspective about whether the objective of the service is to control the impact of animals in a neighborhood, for example, which it's a lot of our kind of calls. Neighbors who there's animals running free and creating danger. So as opposed to the job is to provide the best service to the animal, Those are different perspectives, and it's not as though there's a West Sacramento way only. You know, West Sacramento, we don't care about animal welfare. We do, and or the Davis doesn't care about animal the cost or the control of their neighborhood impacts. But there are differences in the way that we approach these kinds of issues. And I think we would want to, if it were purely council choice, as if we were operating this as our own program, we would be very thoughtful about how much additional responsibility we want to take on, just as we do in every other domain. When we deal with, as we've had the conversation about homelessness, what is our responsibility for homelessness, and what is the responsibility of the county health care and mental health system, and how do we align those together? But we don't simply say our job is to deal with the entire continuum of care, for example, or wraparound services. We cannot do that. We cannot become the entire human welfare system in the community. And probably similarly so for animal services and animal welfare. But we would have that policy conversation. We wouldn't simply enter into a JPA with an expectation that our job was to be primarily attentive to services from the perspective of the animal. I'm stating the case more starkly than it is, because I know most of us have, I haven't heard from my colleagues, but most of our community cares for, and it's home to lots and lots of animals of various kinds, not just whales and mountain lions. And so it matters a great deal, but these questions are exactly the sorts of questions about, and I think it was right, as Ms. McGuire said, precisely correct, which is, what kind of community are we? And I don't know exactly on these questions, because we haven't engaged them in the way that we will as a part of this process. But I know we're not automatically exactly the same community as Woodland, or automatically the same community as Winters, or as Davis, or as Dunnigan. And figuring that out and having a policy mechanism that allows us to preserve those distinctions it makes a difference. We've seen JPAs get out of control, quite honestly, because this is not a jurisdiction issue, but we've got a lot of folks in Davis with a aspirational view of the world and some of the policy domains that we have, and less issues around poverty and crime than we have. And we don't have the resources to be able to be all of those things and also construct the levee to keep the water from flooding and killing humans and animals in the community. We have to make those choices. And so we've reached different conclusions, and that has caused some significant problems in at least a couple of the JPAs in the county. And so we need to, it's not an argument not to do it. Doing this together makes a lot of sense, but designing it in a way that accounts for, that's very honest about that from the front end, and says, okay, Woodland and Davis and Westac are not exactly the same. How do we design a system that accounts for those values as they might be expressed differently, and then design systems that will allow them to retain their own sense of community, their own sense of self, and their priorities and their fiscal priorities in a way that align with that. So to me, those are the kind of the key issues, which is the design of the institution and how it can retain democratic policy control that's community, that's legitimate for each of the communities that are involved, and then dealing with this as a fiscal management issue that is parallel to the rest of the services that we provide, both locally and on a countywide basis. When the item comes back for an actual, when we get either a workshop or some other action item, I would also like to see more examination of the Sacramento shelter option. I know that's been explored and considered, but I'd like to know more about it and understand what the challenges or the opportunities might be in that regard as well. It seems to me, just intuitively, based on the numbers that we've seen and the charts that have been shared with us, that there is an opportunity to do all of these things, right? That we can be dramatically better in terms of animal welfare and animal care, and cost less, and be more effective at all of our objectives. It seems like that's possible. So I don't mean to throw cold water on the idea, only that it's critical that we design it right from the front end, so that we don't have the kind of either breakdown or nuclear war that has erupted in some of these other JPAs. Mayor Pro Tem Villegas.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I think you've done a pretty good job of laying out some legitimate concerns. And I will say that I agree with your position on the structure of the JPA. I know that I've also participated over the course of my last 12 years here on the council and seen how JPAs can't take on a life of their own. So if it's not clear from the get, it does the potential to go sideways, and I think the structure needs to be cleared. The whole idea of the multifunctional makes me equally nervous for that very reason. And then the budget issue, and I'm not going to restate it, it almost seems like we're backing into it if we say, well, this is what the funds that we have, and we can convert or turn what is currently 18 positions into 30 positions. I need to understand how we get to why we need 30 positions if currently what we're getting is 18, and it seems to be working okay. It's not perfect, but the things that we want beyond the 18 positions of our current budget needs to be illustrated or at least broken out or understood as part of the structure of what this JPA would be taken on. So without restating, I think you raise a lot of good points. And I just want us to be mindful of the original purpose of exploring these joints, the joint services countywide was largely because we were all tightening our belts at the same time. So we wanted to find efficiencies in the system, not necessarily anything other than that. And so the efficiencies needs to be front and center as we have these conversations, because that was precisely what the purpose of this conversation, as it started several years ago, was all about. And I understand there are other things we can do, but it needs to be focused at least primarily on the efficiencies, the economics of why it makes sense for us. Because frankly, a lot of the services that we do in Yolo County, we do it because we are part of Yolo County, but we share services with Sacramento on so many more other issues that it almost might make sense to explore things across the river in terms of shared services if in fact we're being honest about economies. So I just want to be mindful of that, continue to remind ourselves that that was the whole intent beyond of the shared services conversation.
The only thing I'd add is the experience with the AB 109 process. One good thing about that process was its at least intention to really be doggedly data driven, right? That there's a million ideas about what you could do to reduce the amount of recidivism. And that's how the criminal justice sector and the social services sector is always just, well, I have an idea, let's do this, let's try this, let's do this counseling program, let's do this outreach program, or let's lock people up longer, whatever. And the AB 109 process has been focused around, okay, what is their actual hard research that links those outcomes to it? And that was that. What got my attention on this item that made me think about those kinds of issues is the proposal to start spending money on humane educators and outreach counselors and whatever. I don't want to go there unless it's part of a strategy that is directly strongly. What are the top five things that can be done that will reduce the amount of euthanasia and the amount of problems? Right, that are objectives. As opposed to getting into layering on more and more things that we could be doing, it needs to be driven by what will lead to those improved outcomes, and that we have strong evidence-based decision making to get to that point. Because otherwise, these things get totally out of hand, because we start to think of them as we have the animal budget. We don't have that luxury. I have to see the fire budget next to the police budget, next to the planning budget, next to the water budget, next to the garbage budget, and make the trade-offs. And when we take programs like this and parcel them out and say there's an agency that just does this, it has its own board, or just does this and one other miscellaneous thing, then nobody ever makes those trade-offs, and then you start to get your decisions start to get driven by how much resources you have instead of what actually works and what your priorities ought to be. So I think a lot of progress has been made both by the YC PAWS group, by the variety of animal advocates and supporters both in our own city and throughout the county, and by the managers groups and others. I'm very encouraged by it. I think this is exactly the right conversation to have. I know for some folks it will be disappointing to sit here and think that we would just say, yay, we're going to vote yes for this at the next meeting. We're not. I mean, I'm not. This needs to be worked on, but I think we're on the right track, and now we need to work on getting getting these issues resolved right at the front. So. Mr. Ledesma?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thanks for the presentation update on the issue. It was educational to learn. I frankly have not delved into animal control, understanding the issues involved. So this was very educational for me. I think there's two things I would add on to what's already been said. First, animal control is not the issue that I'm going to throw caution at. It's the JPA. I serve on one that is providing the cautionary tale about what happens when everyone's in charge. In fact, no one's in charge. That's the risk you run, at least from my observation. Now, are there ways in governance structure, in the way that it's the oversight is provided, that we can mitigate that? Yes. And so my feedback is, let's delve into that. And I know our city manager has been involved in all the discussions, so is aware of that, and to make sure that whatever is formed, whatever proposals are made, we kind of think through those items, because I think that is one of the risks that I view this through now. It's like, okay, we're going to create another JPA. You're right. There is a part of, as I've learned through my first 2 years on this council, that there is a part of me that says, okay, great. There's this one board meeting that I have to go to, and I'll cover these five things. But that takes me off the hook for learning about those individual ones and know exactly we're doing the right steps to be the best representative in that particular area that I can be. So I think that's the accountability part we just need to think about as we go to formulate that, because it is important. I think to the folks here supporting, and I understand the issues involved in animal control and animal welfare and what you're urging us to get to, but it does no good if we can't manage the resources we have and we've expended for this, or we look to, because then it won't be a monumental failure on another front, and that does no good in the long run. So I think that's what I worry about. Not to say that it can't be done. I'm just throwing it out there as a cautionary way to look forward. Thank you.
Further? All right. Thank you. This item for presentation only, so it'll. Ms. Crawford's outlined the next steps. We'll look forward to it. Godspeed. All right, item six is we're at the consent agenda now, which is items five through 11. Any item of consent any member of the council wishes to remove? Okay.
I'm going to let it go.
Okay. Mr. Ledesma, anything? I have a couple also. So Mr. Johansson has asked for number 9, which I do also, but also 7 and 10. Okay, so item 7 is consideration of approval of professional services contract with Public Safety Corporation for alarm program administration. So I wanted to highlight this item because we've had an extensive series of policy conversations about the underlying topic of the alarm program and the alarm ordinance, but really about the selection of the provider. So what can you give us more background that is in the report? It just says there was an RFP, and then this one was selected. Is there? I didn't see any more details about the RFP process and the selection process. Is that
sure.
Here?
we did the RFP process. Excuse me for my voice. I'm getting over something. So with 3 vendors, and there are actually only 3 vendors that provide the type of services that we would need. And the rating criteria that we used, let me find it here. The first category was an experience, technical capability, cost, compliance with requirements of the contract, and accessibility and customer service, basically, in the process of asking for their information. The scoring was done by a member of finance, a lieutenant at the department, and myself. And we looked over the contracts. We did reference checks on the references listed in the RFP. And basically, as far as the categories of accessibility, compliance with requirements, they were pretty much the same. they scored relatively equally. And when it came to experience, the vendor of choice was pretty comparable to another vendor. The third vendor actually is just a brand new startup. They only have two clients, so we weren't really comfortable with that level of experience for this project. The cost comparison, there were differences in cost with the vendor of choice and the second vendor that we were looking at. This one was a bit more expensive than the other. However, when we checked references, there was just no comparison in the level of service that was being delivered by the two vendors. So based on that and the technical capability, the vendor of choice laid out, and I attached it to the packet, but they laid out a very detailed, even with pictorials, of how their system would interface with our CAD system, what kind of service and amenities their product would provide to us. The other vendor was very vague in areas, didn't provide information in some of the critical components of what we'd be looking for in our interfacing with CAD. And also, the vendor of choice listed references of cities with our exact CAD system as references so we could check and be comfortable in the fact that they've done this, they know what they're doing with our specific CAD system, and therefore, based on those criteria, we decided to go with that vendor.
And is this the vendor that had been in communication with the department during the preparation of the lead up for the preparation of the ordinance? When the ordinance was presented to us, at least my understanding was that there had already been discussions with a vendor. Was it this one?
Yes. Yes.
I'm going to vote for it. I'm very concerned about that. It's, you know, we've had these issues with red light cameras and other sorts of issues where there's a private vendor that wants to create an arrangement by which the public sector contracts with them. They come to us to work on an ordinance, and then we adopt the ordinance, and then after that they get the contract. I hear what you're saying about the criteria, which is why I'm going to vote for it. But we need different mechanisms for RFP review that don't involve anyone that was involved in the creation of the ordinance. That we need some sort of firewall, because it just doesn't feel right to me that's the system, right? Because the company will now benefit from the enactment of that ordinance, and it came to and told us that we should do that ordinance. It's not illegal in any way. But I would just like to personally have a better firewall between the process of what's the right policy, what's the right ordinance, what's the right law for the city that's separate from who should make money administering it. And it feels like in this case and in most cases we haven't done that, and I feel like we should. Just as a matter of practice, it would make for a more effective contracting process. So.
Mayor, for me.
Yeah, Mr. Ledesma.
Thank you. I appreciate the comments because it was a question mark for me looking through the packet. If possible, in addition to that process, in staff reports, it would be helpful. And in other staff reports, when the RFP comes out, there's usually a table with looking at who applied, and that was not there. I was actually going to pull that because I didn't see it there. But I think we just need to make that a standard practice. It's just because it just left questions out there. And I think this is the public record. This is what the public sees. We need to be able to see that. And if, to your point, you outlined the criteria in which you based it on, it just wasn't apparent to us. So
okay.
Thank you for explaining it.
Okay. All right, thank you. Item 8 is a status update on the West Sacramento Levy Improvement Program, and we have one request to speak on that item, which is by Mrs. Pat Flint. Did I get the right one? The flood program?
As you know, flood control has always been a passion of mine because of public safety. The reverse dialing system, is it working with everybody having cell phones and no longer having landlines? There's no sirens left in West Sacramento to warn people of any disaster that might be coming. school district no longer buses children. Have they gotten rid of buses? Because we were going to use those buses to help evacuation of students now that we have more students in Southport. The River Road is closed due to levee repair. If we had a disaster right now, we have one way in and out, and that's either to go south through Clarksburg, and if they're inundated by specifically a flood, we can't get out that way. And if the River Road is closed and something's going on Jefferson Boulevard, we cannot evacuate out that way. So unless we have boats in our yards, we're stuck there. And we have some major issues that if we did have a flood in West Sacramento, raw sewage, because Oscar mentioned at the last meeting that we're going to have to build a special levee for the pumping station in the south area, correct? Is that correct, Oscar? Is that what I heard you say at the last meeting? I can't ask him a question.
All right. Question time, sorry.
The other thing is we have a major chemical plant here in West Sacramento. We have major gas lines going through the city. We have tanker cars that we're storing out in the port area, with some of them with ammonia, some of them with gas. So my concerns are if we have a flood or a major disaster, our safety issues. There are a couple things that when I read the report, DWR lost their federal funding with the federal government because of a report that they wrote. The feds said that you are no longer eligible for some sort of funding. The closure, I already did the South River Road. Section 221, the Assistant Secretary, as Christopher mentioned, denied the city's request for a waiver for requirements to able federal credit for the CHP academies and the Riverbend. Maybe it was you that mentioned it. I'm sorry, Bill. How does that affect our city? I mean, if the federal government isn't giving funding to the state, we can't get a waiver approved, how are we going to repair our levees? I know that we're all paying taxes for flood control, but I'm concerned about levels of funding at the state and the federal levels. So thank you.
All right. Actually, on this item, I've gotten a separate constituent inquiry about the closure of South River Road, and that project that road remains closed for a variety of reasons. But if we could update the signage or let the newspaper and others know, you know, what the status of that is, because the signage is, you know, reflects the original estimated completion date, and especially with these sorts of projects that involve 500 agencies, they change. But just, you know, for residents and marina owners and others in the area, it would be helpful if you could provide some additional information about what our best estimate is at the moment.
So, right. Bart, to respond to a couple of the questions.
Pardon?
Ask Bart to respond.
Oh, Dave Spock. Okay, yeah, Mr. Spock.
Good evening. So which questions would you like a response on?
Well, I think that the 104 and the 221, okay, and then again with what's going on with South River Road. I probably should have reported on that one earlier, okay, because that is pretty, it's pretty important because it's been extended for about a year or so.
Okay.
But
as council is aware, the framework for funding the overall West Sacramento Levy Improvement Program is built on a three-way cost share, federal, state, and local funding. And in the advance of actual congressional authorization to spend federal money on our improvements, the city is moving as quickly as it can with its partner at the West Sacramento Area Flood Control Agency to advance flood risk reduction projects using local and state funding. Our inability as a community to obtain credit for these advanced improvements is unsettling because it can unhinge the framework for cost sharing that began our enterprise together with the state and federal governments. We're not convinced that the story is over, the game is over. It requires continuous effort, and as the mayor recounted, it's time to advance the next playing piece on the board, which is to move toward a legislative solution. We share the citizens' concerns regarding the lack of federal crediting, and we're going to continue to work on that issue. Is that?
Yeah,
you can cover a few others if you want to. So the Southport Pump Station,
it's really Sacramento going to build that. It's not.
Yes.
Well, there is a levy between us and that station as well. So it's not. That is not. Yeah. That's not within the city at all. It is not.
But there are a number of risks related to flooding in the city beyond us just getting wet. There are a number of hazards related to hazardous materials, chemical contamination, and sewage issues, and it isn't limited to inundation of the main pump station, though there are lift stations throughout the city that are critical infrastructure. But with respect to SRCSD's approach to the pump station south of town, the agency is moving forward in the construction of a ring levee that's intended to secure the facility against a 200-year plus storm event. So that's moving forward. With respect to the Sacramento Bank extension project at the mouth of the barge canal, the Corps of Engineers has encountered a number of unexpected challenges and difficulties during construction. They remain focused on delivering the best flood risk reduction project and that performs as it's supposed to, as the best way to expend the taxpayer dollars, and we compliment them on their focus and their continued quality assurance efforts. Unfortunately, that's resulted in a slowdown in delivery of the project, which is further complicated by the fact that due to regulatory concerns, construction has to stop November 1 and stay stopped along the waterfront through the wintertime, through the high water level. It's our understanding that the combination of the delays is going to result in a continued closure of South River Road throughout 2013. We have been in communication with the project manager at the Corps, and we are expecting that the Corps will be releasing press materials and media information shortly. We've offered the city's website as another media to project that information, and I will be providing City Council and the community with updates as soon as that information is available.
All right, thanks.
Thank you.
Yep.
Just a little bit of a follow-up. I think the EOC, that's the Emergency Control Center, has met once or twice, and I know that they'll be meeting before wintertime, and they're discussing routes in, routes out, buses, sirens. I know they're discussing all of those various issues, and so we will probably be getting a report back sometime, I'm going to say December, that sort of outlines some of the issues that the EOC goes through, because the EOC meet on the fire chiefs and the police chief and various staff, they meet to make sure that our community is safe, and we need to articulate that more. The 221 permit that you'd brought up, it's something I know Christopher has been working very hard on, because what it is what we have done is we have advanced, we've spent tax dollars. We've spent tax dollars, monies that we actually have, but we spent tax dollars. And what happens is you get reimbursed under the old formula of the 104. And that formula has changed. Now we have the 221, and they have said, no, we're not going to reimburse you at this time for monies that you are spending on this. And what happens with those monies is if we get additional dollars, if we get dollars at the back end of it, we can put that into the front end of the next project. We think, and we're pretty sure, that we have all the funding necessary to make sure that we get Reach 8 and Reach 7, Segment F and Segment B. We think that we have adequate funds to get all of that done. And what that means then is that means we will be very, very close to that 50% threshold that FEMA is going to eventually place on cities like ours. We are in an X zone now, which is fine. We'd like to, and we think that we will be able to get all of the work along the Sacramento River levees completed with the amount of money that we have now. And that is a very, very good thing, because then FEMA will look at that very favorably and they will say, well, okay, they're making their effort, they're doing what they're supposed to do. Flood rates stay the same. You don't have to raise the pads for residential, industrial, or commercial development, so that development continues. And so we think we're really on the right track. And maybe we should just articulate that more to make sure we can raise the comfort level of the folks out there.
Well, I'd try a different summary, which is we are engaged in a $500 million, a half a billion dollar flood protection project. It's one of the most complex, most per capita, largest, you know, infrastructure projects in the country for any city. And it's going to take 15, 20 years to complete. And every one of those years, there will be 16 of the frustrations that Mr. Shapak was identifying tonight, and we will overcome 16 of them in one way or another. I mean, a year and a half ago, it was FEMA mapping is going to happen any second, everything's going to shut down. We got over that. Then it was some other issue, which we got over. Then it was vegetation on the levees. We were punching through them. And the notion that it's just going to be one straight, easy line, that everything will go the way that we thought it was going to go the day before, that's not how these kind of major public infrastructure projects work. We are blazing the trail for the rest of the country in many ways. And we have the full support of the United States Army Corps of Engineers, the U.S. Senate, the White House, and many, many others. We will get there, but it's going to be like any other process that would involve 37 bureaucratic agencies and $500 million. It's going to be complicated, and there's going to be a couple steps backwards, sometimes for five steps forward. So I think more important than the details of these specific things, which we will work through, we are on track. Compared to before, we are one of the only places that hasn't been remapped. We have many actual levee projects in the ground so that the people of this community are significantly safer from any flood risk than they were just a couple of years ago, and more than any other community in the region are on track to deliver the next large project that will get to that FEMA standard. So I think there is significant progress, and we continue to be challenged, and we'll have to continue to overcome them. All right, item 9 is consideration of resolution 12-48, approving the Transportation Development Act claim for fiscal year 2012-13. Mr. Johannesson.
Just a quick question on this. Let me just get the. So basically, this is to get an allocation from SACOG to do some transportation projects that we have. And the analysis indicates that SACOG conducted their annual unneeds transit process, which resulted in the city of West Sacramento having no unmet transit needs for the reasonable that are reasonable to meet, which gives the city justification to use that money in some other points.
Correct.
Well, one of the things I wanted to bring up is when we're looking at our transportation plan, it's not just the streets and bicycles and streetcars and that type of thing, but right now we've got, I think the U.S. population of aging is something like 13% over 65. 2050, it's going to be about 26%. So there's a lot of transportation issues that deal specifically with aging in place that we've talked about here that are age-specific transportation issues, not necessarily streetcars, but access to the facilities and that type of thing. So I want to make sure that before we leave the issue of whether we've met or not our transportation needs, that we give consideration to the aging in place. I think it's important to a lot of folks right now. We're seeing it particularly with our senior center. It's hard for people to get around, and it's been a challenge to do that. You know, of course, farmers market and things like that people want to get to, but there are issues, including the ability to walk down a sidewalk with a walker when, you know, you've got sidewalks that may not be totally repaired. So, you know, I just want to make sure before we start spending money on something else that we really look at the holistic approach of transportation in terms of serving all the ages in our community.
Absolutely.
And I want to jump in on this 100% with what Mr. Johannesson said, and I would like this item to be continued. I've dealt with this issue not just here, but on the receiving end at SACOG. And, you know, one of the concerns that I had when we reorganized and downsized the organization, that we would start to move in a public works, I mean, not in a derogatory, but a public works perspective on this pot of funding. Every public works director in the region practically tries to do this, which is, how do I minimize the amount of money directed to transit so I can have more money for roads, which is a public works responsibility. But the unmet needs process is not designed to determine are we investing the right amount of money in transit. The unmet needs bar is extremely low. We never have any unmet transit needs. But ask a transit rider, or ask the neighborhoods where we are building transit-oriented development, but there's no transit service yet. We have transit needs, but to be an unmet transit need, you have to have extra money as well. There has to be resources available, and if you keep directing the resources to some other purpose, that never happens. So, to me, this item is a really critical one in terms of assuring that what we're doing when we do this each year is making not a judgment about the unmet transit needs, but our own transportation plans and our general plan, and are we making the right investments in transit and roads and whatever the modes are, rather than think of it as just whatever doesn't qualify on the SACOG bar automatically goes into this other fund. So I personally would like to see this continued and have y'all take another look at it from the perspective of how does this line up with our general plan and our specific plans for the Bridge District and the Washington area and the downtown and Southport and everywhere else in the community, because that's really what it should be, is if we have it doesn't prohibit us from spending more money on transit, and we've said repeatedly one of our challenges with the transit-oriented development that we have been improving in our planning documents is that, well, we don't have the money to run the transit. Well, we certainly won't if the money that is for transit gets directed to a different purpose. So without prejudging it, I don't know what the right, I mean, it may be we come to the conclusion that this is the right number, but I don't get the sense that we've had that policy conversation even at the staff level, much less here.
You are correct that since 2005, 2006, all of the unused excess TDA funds have been diverted towards a carry forward balance for future transit services. This year, if we were to continue that direction, we would have a reserve built up of $1.8 million, which is actually more than this year YOLO buses service charges for transportation. We are awaiting YCTD's updated SRTP to help us guide us with the right amount of dollars to allocate towards future usage. Unfortunately, the 2005 SRTP, those numbers were based on a high projection of growth, which we did not meet. And every year, the allocation has met the request, except for 2 years where there was a 7% shortage. Those factors were taken into consideration in addition to the unmet need process.
Yes, but transit service is not exogenous. We are the ones that decide.
Absolutely.
We are the ones that decide through our representative on the YCTD board what the level of request from YOLO bus is. And I think we can be quite certain, given the amount of denser development that we have built and our commitment that we have said from the outset that when we open a project up, that it will have transit service to the extent that we can fund it from the beginning, as opposed to waiting for people to move in and having to find other ways to get around because the transit service isn't there yet. But that we can only do that if we're making our budget allocations match up with that policy. So that ought to be a decision that we are making affirmatively here about which of these resources, where should they be going? Again, without prejudice, it may be that we come to the conclusion they should all go towards sidewalks. Maybe that's what we decide. But that's a policy decision. These items have typically been consent ministerial items because we've been saying all the money goes to transit, right? So that made sense, that just do it on consent. There's no policy issue to be determined, but now there is. And so I think this ought to come back with a more complete analysis and recommendation.
Very good. Thank you.
Is there an objection to doing that? Okay. All right. Thank you. All right. Oh, then item 10 is consideration of approval of task orders with Fair and Pierce to complete a transportation management plan and circulation element for the U.S. Housing and Urban Development Sustainable Communities Challenge Grant. So the reason I asked for this one is to, what are the deliverables that we will have at the end of this? You know, you recall from when we started this process, I know there are several of us, me in particular, concerned about we don't want to do more we don't want to do more studies that will produce more information. But what if there? What we want are if there are things that private parties can do or other government agencies or us that could happen, but for this one thing, right? That this project would produce actual deliverables that would then allow for some change in the world, not just a study that would sit on a shelf. So what could we expect that's going to come out of this transportation management plan that will be that?
Well, good topic prior, because I think it feeds right in and facilitates, the work effort that we're going to be doing with the transportation management plan related to the Sustainable Communities Challenge Grant, which is to look at some of these deficiencies, in particular because the grant is isolated to the Washington Specific Plan area. We will look at transit deficiencies. We will look at streetscape improvements. We will look and talk to the community about some of the lack of transit service. And ultimately, we take an approach where we look at the kind of existing conditions, and then we run models to determine what levels of service we need out in that community. Ultimately, what it drives to is an element in a document, the TMP, which will categorize specific kind of needs for the area and goals and policy decisions that staff is going to have to return to the council and ask for some guidance and determination of what's classified as key and importance of the particular findings from the various facts that we would reveal through our work that we would produce with the grant. So I think to sum it up, basically we're looking at parking demand analysis, we're looking at transit as it relates to headways, we're looking at serving the commercial businesses out there, CalSTRS, DGS, we're engaging them as stakeholders and having set to have meetings with them to find out what their employees want in that community as far as transit, which the initial talks have already began, and it's kind of revealing of what their needs are. So our main goal is to really look at the area and improve in the current transit needs for that area.
Yeah, so I want to get there too. What I don't want to end up with is a document that's mainly about the needs, right? This isn't the city of LA. It's a small enough city that and we all travel all around it and live all around it, that if we spend $500,000 and we end up with lots of needs assessments that identify all the things that we wish we could have or be without, instead of using resources to develop the tools or take down the barriers that are needed to I'd rather have meet a couple needs than identify 500 of them. And so that's the key balance. I mean, if it is in the end, what will result is a parking ordinance, or there'll be a it'll be a template for 3 grant applications for some transit service, or something that will actually that you as a resident or as a restaurant owner in the Washington neighborhood, that you will know a difference in your neighborhood as a result of this work that we're doing, these resources that we're spending, as opposed to we'll know more about what we can't do. Right, so that's the critical piece that we want to make life. We actually want to make this to end up making life better in that neighborhood now, through the result of this work, not simply giving us an idea, an aspiration of where we might go if we were to have other, some other resources. So that's what I'm trying to drive, just continually driving the management of these, of the specific components of this strategy, to be leading to either direct action or to creating some tool or removing some barrier so that somebody else can take the right actions to make it happen, as opposed to needs assessment generally.
Jim, don't we have a lot of this data now on the books? Because you know, Fair and Paris has done a number of studies in the Washington area for the Washington specific plan. Every time we have a major development that comes in, like CalSTRS, or they do a traffic management plan. I mean, so don't we have this information already?
I think what you're characterizing is more specific to project related, based on the generation of a particular project. What the work that we're going to embark on here is more than just, you know, about what is level of service in various intersections. This is going to review and look at the land use spread of that area and apply some fundamental transit concepts to the area and determine best utilization of transit needs based on dense development, based on future scenarios in the economic climate, and based on waterfront development, and apply some standards, apply some type of information that we can move forward towards getting to the mayor's question of answering what do we really need as far as some level of improvement, with laying out some cold, hard kind of goals and policies of what we need to do to improve the transit out there in that community. So we view this work as more of a comprehensive review of that area that will look at streetcar, that will look at the various plan projects for that area, and some of the work that you characterized in the prior projects really looked at just what happens when a project comes to this particular parcel and how that gets spread, that traffic gets spread through that particular particular intersection. This goes beyond that to look at the river crossing that could potentially occur, look at streetcar, could also look at you know, various needs that are unmet, as we just discussed here, and what we filter out from the community as we engage them through the three-year grant process.
What does that look like? And yeah. So, I mean, what I'm hearing, but I'm trying to, my bad filter, is that we'd get a document that would have a paragraph about a streetcar and a paragraph about river crossing. About the needs that they could meet, whereas which I don't know what I would do with, because I already know. I mean, it might give me a little bit more ammunition if I knew what, if it was telling me what to shoot at, right? It's some process, some something. Or I'd rather say, okay, forget, pick one of the, pick your river crossing, future bus routes, parking study, streetcar. Pick one of those. Pick streetcar and deliver a streetcar alignment and everything necessary to get to the point where you would start working on doing NEPA work or something, you know, where there's, at the end of that process, you actually had something that you would then be able to do something with, as opposed to sort of touching on a bunch of needs without not just an eye towards future action, but actually doing the initial work on one or more of those options, so that we or somebody else could pick up the ball. Or if we were to do the bridge replacement, the I-Street bridge replacement project that's, you know, contemplated right now, and that freed up the piece of property where the bridge currently lands, for example, you know, rather than a paragraph that says that's a future opportunity, okay, give us a draft site plan of, you know, of what could be those sorts of actual, you know, actual deliverables, as opposed to a sort of a specific plan light. Which is that's the main concern I've had, is we end up with something that we can't do anything with, other than sort of in general, in an abstract way, guide our future decisions about other things.
I get your comment, and I think to add to that is there was a grant process. We had to lay out some fundamental kind of deliverables and what we were going to assess, and, you know, they do their little points, you know, for, you know, giving us a grant. We are at a stage, you know, we're still early on, that I could, you know, carry that forward to HUD, to my technical advisor, and just kind of maybe work with some of the comments that I'm hearing from you, take that back, and maybe we do kind of shift some things as far as, because you described it pretty perfectly, is that we are like a specific plan light of what the deliverable ultimately will come of this. And I think maybe, you know, there's still some opportunity to reshape this a little bit, and I can carry that back and see if I can make some headway.
there's a knife hitting in your back right now.
Bob Grandy with Fair and Peers. I did want to mention that part of our product, the ultimate product for this, is going to be to identify specific strategies, both on the transit side and on the access to transit side, pedestrian and bicycle, to bring some particular specific improvement strategies back as part of the end product. So it's not just to update the plan itself, but to have that implementation component where you actually have action items. So you have projects defined that you can go out and either implement with local funds or find grant funding for. So that is an element of what is included in the scope that's before you tonight.
No, that's helpful. I want to push towards one step beyond the strategy. Like, here's the strategy, and here is the here is the nucleus of something that we've already started to work on, that gives us a platform with which actually to do the recommendation. Because we've got strategies and recommendations that are, they're not a dime a dozen, but they're, you know, maybe a dollar a dozen. I mean, if there are actual usable deliverables that would get us towards those strategies, in addition to knowing what the strategy is, it would be hugely helpful. Because most of the strategies are, I wish I had the first dollar, right? If I could do the streetcar, if I knew what the phase three streetcar alignment looked like, then I could, you know, then I have something to go shop with SACOG or with, you know, someone else. I could actually make something happen. If all I have is a sentence and a paragraph that follows it up saying, and the city should consider a streetcar line that serves the north as a strategy, then I can't, that's great, but now what? There's no way to leap from that to an actual action. Whereas if there's something produced that gives us a leg up in a grant application or direction to go, then we can actually make life, we can improve the neighborhood in a much more real and tangible way. So enough soapbox. Mr. Johannesson.
Yeah, thanks. I maybe just reiterate some of the comments I made in the last item on the aging issue, and including that in the needs analysis. But, you know, if we're talking about some type of specific plan light, then it seems that one of the things you're going to be doing when you're looking at needs is you're going to be identifying possible funding sources as well. Stakeholders or, you know, within a certain number of blocks from a streetcar line, for example, and start getting an idea of where, you know, where user fees might come from or where property tax assessments might come from. Is that part of this analysis?
Yes, correct.
Okay, good.
Further discussion? All right, so the level of specificity that's in the task order, I mean, you've described that you in terms of what we're approving this evening is every word in the attached scope of work. Or so if you were to take a look at how to, you know, maybe deepen some of the pieces, even if it means dropping the breadth of some others, is that possible within this framework, or does it need to come back?
I think if you're comfortable with it, you can give Jim the direction. There may be some modifications to the task order that you can work with Fair and Peers on. Or some more specific examples or something. But if you're comfortable with the direction you've given him, I think you could approve the task order.
Right. Well, it would be to the city manager. So.
And then be able to come back, maybe on consent, but the revised scope of work?
Well, or, I mean, if you feel, I mean, I don't, if you feel that you can, that what we've talked about is possible, and I'm talking about rewriting the whole thing, obviously, we're far along this process, but.
I think it is. I think the comment about actual deliverables for the amount of money that we're putting in here, we need to have that. And I think that Mr. Grandy mentioned in terms of the, maybe it was misuse of words here, but in the staff write-up, a comprehensive strategy, I think what we're really looking at is a detailed implementation plan, which is helpful for the next step. And so if there is focus on that, I think that addresses a lot of concerns that have been expressed tonight.
Okay. And I understand that, you know, the grant itself, the whole program does require needs assessment. I'm not saying we should just, like, go charging into the night, guns blazing. So there are those components that we must do. It's really a question of both emphasis and making sure that there are some deliverables. So I'm comfortable with the delegation to the city manager to, you know, to make those appropriate changes without having to come back here unless members of the council feel otherwise. But.
I'd agree.
Okay. All right. So with that, we've got the consent agenda in front of us, minus item 9. Been moved by Mayor Pro Tem Viegas.
Second.
And seconded by Mr. Johannesson. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none. Motion carries. Item 12 is a continuation of CDB community development block grant public hearing for consideration of the 2011-2012 grantee performance report. Ms. Collis.
Good evening. We're here this evening to ask the City Council to conduct a public hearing to review activities funded by Community Development Block granting funding in the past fiscal year. This is a requirement of the grants that we receive from the State Department of Housing and Community Development. CDBG funds are primarily used for low-income persons and for the benefit of the lower-income community. Over the past 10 years, the city has been very successful in applications to the state for CDBG funding. We've garnered $9 million in grants. Some of that money was placed into loans that are performing loans, which has brought back another almost $4 million to be recycled into the program. So that's almost $13 million worth of projects and programs and activities that have been conducted over 10 years. When CDBG funds are used, as I mentioned, it's primarily for low-income families. The activities this past year are on the screen before you. 16 shelter persons received shelter at the Yolo Wayfarer Center in Woodland with our CDBG funding. We've assisted some first-time homebuyer families, not as many as in years past, but it was a slow market this year. We've actually seen an uptick in that in the last couple months. As you can see, currently underway, we have three more loans. Jobs has been, creation has been a big activity for our CDBG program in the past year or two. And 29 new jobs this year. We actually have a project on board that hopefully will create another 65 jobs in the coming year. These numbers, to me, when I see $9 million, I expect bigger numbers than this. But remember that the $9 million is cumulative. So in addition to what you see here this year, you know, we have 216 units in Arlington Oaks that received new sewers many years ago. Those sewers are still actively functioning and serving that community. We have a total of 56 families we've helped with first-time home buyer loans. 296 units of housing at Harbor Park. So the cumulative effect of that $9 million is very significant. One of the things that we've also been successful with is leveraging private investment with our CDBG money. And as you can see the chart in front of us, these are just activities for the past fiscal year and that are currently underway, a little over $4 million in grants that will bring in $26 million of private investment. That's from private mortgages from our first-time home buyers. It's homeless funding that was secured by the homeless coordinator, whom we pay a portion of her salary with our CDBG money. That's the Yolo County homeless coordinator. The HUD challenge grant that was discussed before, a portion of the city's match is coming from our CDBG grant. So in a number of ways, we've really magnified the impact of that funding. That concludes my presentations. Did you have any questions?
Yourself? All right, then we are going to open the public hearing on item 12. We have no request to speak on this item, but it's a public hearing, so I'll ask if anyone wishes to address the council. If not, we'll close the public hearing. Return to the council. Any further questions or discussion? All right, is there a motion? It's been moved by Mayor Pro Tem Villegas and seconded by Mr. Ledesma. All those in favor, please say aye. Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none. Motion carries. We're just tired. It's a big deal, Louise. It was a great summary of some really consequential projects for the for the community, you didn't go through a lot of the details, thankfully, but as you, even though you described that the CDBG is targeted towards meeting the essential needs and create economic opportunities for the lowest income members of our community, that really it serves all of West Sacramento in a lot of ways, partly because so many of us, our family, our friends, either are in the long run or temporarily or find themselves in that situation. And also because things like creating jobs at the eatery or at Denny's or at the Capitol Bowl, it creates a better quality of life for everyone in the community. And so, I mean, if you look at this item and all you think about it is the fact that it serves low-income programs or whatever, yes, but there's also many, many other benefits, preschool, many, many other benefits for the community at large. And so thanks very much. All right, item 13 is grant authority to the city manager to sign the revised memorandum of understanding for the Downtown Riverfront Transit Study and provide a verbal update on the status of the study.
Mr. Mayor and council members, Olin Woods, working as a consultant for Public Works. There are two parts to item 13, as the mayor has indicated. The first is the approval of an MOU and an update on the project. And with your concurrence, staff will provide an update first and then ask for your action on the MOU. You have a map in front of you, and we'll shortly, I think, have a map up for the audience. Just to give you a brief tour of the streetcar line, I don't believe it's changed a great deal from the last time that you saw it. It takes off from, if you go over to the left, it takes off from City Hall, comes up the TBG, goes across the Tower Bridge, makes a left turn at 3rd Street on the Sacramento side, and then it goes over to the rail yards. There's a couple of options there. The city's working that out with a consultant now. Goes down H Street to 7th, from there over to the mall, up the mall to the convention center, then around the convention center on J Street down to 19th Street, which may be new from the last time you saw this map. Then back down L Street to the convention center, back down the mall, and returns to West Sacramento. The stations are shown there in red, and there's co-located stations with RT along the mall, which are shown in blue. As the council knows, there have been two previous streetcar projects, one headed up by West Sacramento. That would have been financed without federal funds. Then a second study by the city of Sacramento to address specific issues of concern on Sacramento's side of the river. At the conclusion of the second study, last year, both cities wished to go forward and a decision was made to seek federal funds. Fortunately for this project, Sacramento RT had a lapsing project on the books worth about $1.2 million, and FTA agreed to allow that funding to shift over to this project, provided that SACOG took over the study as a regional neutral agency. You'll hear a little later on from Kirk Trost, who's here from SACOG, to talk about their perspectives on the project. The study cost, the West Sacramento share of this cost, the match, is $40,000. The total capital cost for the eventual construction project, and that includes track, catenary stations, and vehicles, is approximately $130 million. Study partners are West Sacramento, of course, the City of Sacramento, SAC-RT, SACOG, and YCTD. The governing board is called the Project Steering Committee. It's comprised of elected officials and business community representatives. The mayor sits on that council, on that committee, Council Member Ledesma, and as an alternate, Council Member Johannesson. The business community rep is Mark Friedman. West Sacramento is represented well on that committee, as Mike McGowan from YCTD sits on the committee, and his alternate is Council Member Villegas. FYI, there are two vacancies now on the business community side, and we've got some excellent candidates that we plan to send forward very soon to the mayor and to the council. The staff equivalent of the steering committee is a project management team, which is composed of staff from all five agencies. It meets biweekly at SACOG. It met today. The consultant for the project is Bob Grandy, and Bob is here, as you know, and from Fair and Peers, and will talk to you also briefly. Current major issue that the PMT is dealing with is, of course, funding. And here in West Sacramento, we've got an excellent team we put together to creatively and aggressively address the financing issue, which is arguably the most important aspect of the project. On that team, and she's here this evening, is Katie Jacobson. Nitish Chandra is upstairs working on follow-up budget issues. Aaron Laurel is here. Paul Blumberg couldn't make it tonight, and John Robinson is also here. Other issues that the project management team's dealing with currently are confirmation of the alignment. There's still a few loose ends on that. The siting of the maintenance facility, one of the facilities that's under consideration, is under the Pioneer Bridge here in West Sacramento. We feel that's got a lot of benefits, direct and indirect. And then the Sacramento RT is still considering bringing a four-car train across the bridge for games at Raleigh Field and also special events. So in conclusion, there's a strong commitment on both sides of the river to this project. There's excellent cooperation among the staff of the five agencies. There's strong leadership by both SACOG and the consultant. The project lines up well with the new FTA criteria for transit projects. And we believe there's an excellent prospect that the project will be ready to go to the next step by February or March 2013. So that concludes my comments. If you don't have any questions for me, I'll bring up Kirk Trost, and he can talk with you a little bit about SACOG's involvement.
Mr. Johannesson?
Couple questions. In your presentation, you're starting to throw out numbers for cost. And my understanding is that you haven't specified exactly the kind of system that's going to be run on this route. For example, there's still the analysis of barriers, whether or not overhead lines are going to be possible in an area, the cost effectiveness of doing a wireless system. I know we've had conversations about that, and I understand that a decision hasn't been made, at least, or I haven't seen an analysis on that yet.
Correct. And that's, all those things are going to be part of this study effort.
Okay.
And part of the environmental document. And all of those things we hope to get, we're moving on now, and we want to get the environmental started as soon as we can. In fact, with the disarray of the FTA guidelines at the moment because of the new federal act possible change of administration, they are reluctant to give out direct guidance consistently. Now, we have some sources in different places that have given us some pretty good direction. So we're not slowing down, despite that confusion by FTA.
All right, thank you.
Mayor, members of the council, happy to be here tonight and certainly welcome to answer any of your questions. Let me just talk briefly. SACOG was asked to get involved in this project, and we're pleased to be involved in what is a very important regional project. We're going to be working with the project team on a lot of the funding issues, on the governance issues, on which I in particular have had a lot of experience in the region, working on joint agreements, joint powers agreements, other types of cooperative MOUs to help the partners work together to develop a governance structure for both the initial project development phase as well as the capital phase of the project and ultimately the operations and maintenance of the project. But we're also working with the team as a project manager. And our goal here is to utilize the expertise that we have at the City of West Sacramento. We have at Regional Transit, YCTD, and at the City of Sacramento to get everyone involved in the project in a very active way. But what we're trying to do, and what the mayor was saying with respect to the community's Sustainable Communities Grant, we are very much focused on results here. This group had originally scoped a $400,000 request for proposal to get a consultant to help work with moving this project forward. We took that and negotiated it down and rescoped it to $280,000 in the initial phase so that we could really focus on what we needed to do to take this project from where it is today into project development, which will eventually lead to an application for federal funding for this project. And we're constantly asking that question. We asked that question again today about 12 different ways to say, what do we really need to do? We don't want to do studies. We don't want to do anything that's not absolutely required right now to get us to the next phase. And we are in this period of uncertainty, not knowing what the federal guidance is under the new transportation bill to get us to that next phase. We're talking to all the people we can, but we're making sure that we put ourselves in the right position. One of the things we're going to be talking to the steering committee about in December is whether we can immediately move this project into the environmental phase, something that we had not expected to be doing until well into 2013 or 2014 potentially. There is a scenario under the new guidance where we might be able to do that as soon as this year in order to shorten the project development phase and get us to a point of applying for federal funding for actual construction of this project as early as late 2013 to get in the president's budget by 2014. Those are all scenarios. We don't really know the answer, but we're trying to stay on top of it. The message being, we're trying to move this project forward, thinking about outcomes, not thinking about studies that we can all put on our shelves. I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Mayor Pro Tem Villegas.
Just real briefly, thank you. Your comments were perfectly timed, and your focus on sort of outcomes versus studies was very helpful. I couldn't help but the last meeting. I know we have all been working on this for quite some time, and I know the committee's been kind of grappling with, you know, is the consultant come before the study or the study comes before the consultant, and it just seems like we've had a series of that kind of conversation. And sitting next to Mark Friedman, who is a private developer, doesn't necessarily always sit at meetings where we have those kinds of conversations. And I looked over at him at one point and he said, I don't even understand why we're doing what we're doing now. He's just completely confused with how much studying we've had to do. And it is complicated, but I think the emphasis has now been placed on more deliverables, more specific scoping, more objectives that actually lead to work on the product versus more studies, which I know we have to do, but to the extent that we can limit that and actually do more specific work to accomplish some of the objectives that we've all identified, it sounds like that's where we're headed. It's good information. I know our contribution at this point is what, 40,000, so I know that we've put a whole lot more into it before this, but it's good stuff. Thank you.
Mr. Ledesma.
Thank you. Thanks for the update on where we are with the streetcar and the transit study, and I echo a lot of what Mayor Pro Tem Villegas has said about the focus on the deliverables and the outcomes. I think it has been my year being on this. I've seen this renewed energy from our colleagues across the river, the members of the City Council from there, who have really started to champion this. So I sense the shift and I think we're seeing the shift of all of us being focused on getting to a place where we can actually start applying and looking for federal funding. So this is a terrific place we are. I'm curious in terms of the four, you know, one of the challenges of this is having the four agencies sit down, you know, five, including yours, sit down and being able to work through the issues. Is the level of cooperation, I'm just kind of curious on sort of, is it filtering down to all the agencies working together? Can you give me a sense of, is everybody on board and everybody?
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. We've accelerated the number of PMT meetings, project management team meetings we're having there every other week. The agendas are full. Everyone's pulling their weight. I've made sure I've communicated to the consultant that if he's not getting the things that he needs from individual members in terms of the meetings, the information with respect to governance or funding or whatever, he needs to talk to me so that I'll make sure I talk to the necessary people, each one of the jurisdictions, so that we get where we really need to get on this. And I couldn't speak more highly of all of the people that are working on that team. I think they're all feeling it from their own policymakers that this is important and people want to see some progress on this project.
It is. I'm glad to hear that, and I've sensed that in past meetings from the staff level, that everyone's enthused about it and engaged. And it is something to see the map showing that how it ties all, everything ties together from both sides of the river, how the route to run from the Midtown area to the river district, to the bridge district, to Washington district. It just sort of, it looks like something real. So, thank you.
Mr. Grandy?
Good evening. I've been asked to speak briefly about what the consultant team is doing, and the first thing we're doing is being very flexible because, as was mentioned, we are in a bit of flux at the federal level. The good news about Map 21 was it included some streamlining provisions and some change in criteria by which they judge projects for new starts and small starts funding that are very positive for projects like the streetcar project. The challenge for us is that until FTA produces guidance on that bill, and with Safety Lou in 2005, it took about 6 months for them to release guidance. And that would put them out into about January or February. Until they produce that, FTA staff are not ready to talk to us and our team about what exactly we need to be doing to fit into that streamlined process. And so what we're doing is being very flexible as a team right now. We have an excellent team with HDR who did the engineering previously, done 70% of the engineering on the line. We're working to complete that. They also are working on the LA streetcar and did the design work for Salt Lake and Tucson that are under construction right now. So a great engineering firm working with us. URS, another great engineering firm helping us on the environmental. They did the EIR previously. We're working with them now about what we need to do for NEPA to meet the federal requirements for the environmental process. We've got SOJ out of Portland, who's with Portland Streetcar Inc., helping us with governance issues and thinking through those processes. We've got a really good team, but remaining flexible, and as things change and we see different opportunities, we're making changes within the scope of the team to make sure we're responsive to that. Specifically right now, we're working on putting the project description together for NEPA. We want to be able to initiate that process as quickly as possible with FTA, and that's what we're working on as part of it. And it was mentioned that there are a few details we're working out on the alignment. Those are largely to define things like the maintenance facility and make sure we pin down the stop locations, all those kind of details that have to be in the environmental documents. So we're getting that nailed down. We're working on the funding strategy. We spent 2.5 hours last week with your funding and economic development staff. We'll be back again for another 3-hour session in 2 weeks, working on those issues because inextricably tied the funding plan and the economic development benefits. We're talking about those side by side. And we're working on the governance, what needs to happen not only at the local level so that all the agencies make sure there's a structure in place to bring this project forward on each of the stages, both project development, construction, and implementation, but also that we showed FTA that we have the project management capabilities and the technical capabilities to deliver this project, which is the key to getting federal funding. So those are all the elements that we're currently working on. I'd be happy to answer any questions you might.
Thank you.
Thanks.
We've completed the presentation, and so we can move to the MOU. The staff report is fairly comprehensive. The changes that were made in the organization of the MOU mainly relate to the voting. Members Cabaldon and
Friedman.
Both were in favor of it. We've spoken with fairly extensively, I think, counselor, on this, and city attorney has no objections and has approved it to form. So staff, unless you would like further discussion, staff would ask for your positive vote.
Okay.
So
the The title of the agenda item says give the city manager the authority to sign this. The whole agenda item references, the action item is authorizing me to sign it. The staff report describes that it would be provided to the mayor for signature, and then the actual document is has the city manager's.
It should be there's some inconsistencies in there. It is intended to be the mayor's signature.
Okay.
Has it as the mayor.
Yes.
The agenda has it as the city manager. Is there any problem with just making that change?
No.
All right, any further discussion? All right, then, is there a motion? Mr. Johannesson moves.
And I'll second.
Mr. Kristoff seconds. All those in favor, please say aye. Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Thank you. Thanks to the whole team.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kirk.
And Mr. Mayor and Council, Olin Woods has not
really been introduced. Is new to SACOG as a consultant, really has stepped in, done a fabulous job working with SACOG. I want to just reiterate what Kirk said is I think we've got the right team, the right formula for a successful project. We heard earlier this morning from our federal advocate that we've got a window here of 18 months. I think we've got a great team, and it's just delightful to have Olin here and leverage his expertise on project delivery with our public works staff. But he's just a great addition.
Yeah, the whole team. I mean, the whole team is terrific. I think Mr. Ledesma said, maybe it was Kirk that said that the policymakers are pushing on the teams to work, and that's certainly true. But I think, what is more happening is that there is the team members here, but at the other jurisdictions too, want to do this project. They have been excited about the project, but they get excited when there's a project that's actually moving forward, and when they're working on it, it actually produces a result. And that's happening now, and so I think it's good management, and it's been a great set of folks from throughout the jurisdictions that have been coming together to be creative and to really be results focus. Terrific.
I would just say that
Olin and you served together.
Yeah, we served together on LAFCO, and he's just an old hand at this, So. Yeah.
Thank you.
Right, council calendar. Mr. Richardson, you still over there?
Yes, Mr. Mayor. There's not much to report on the calendar. We have the election coming up on November 6th, and our next council meeting is on November 7th. Good luck to those who are running.
Oh, this is it. Good. Any questions on the calendar?
Thank God.
City manager report?
Just briefly. The mayor and Supervisor McGowan, representing the port, participated in our federal lobbyist interviews this morning. We started very early. We appreciate the mayor and Supervisor McGowan's role in that. We'll be able to have an announcement on that selection here very soon.
A recommendation?
Yes.
To the council. All right. Any questions on the city manager report? City attorney report?
Nothing to report.
Staff direction from members of the council? And we have no... We have no future agenda item requests. Is there a motion to adjourn?
Second.
Moved by Mayor Pro Tem Villegas, seconded by Mr. Kristoff. All those in favor, please say aye. Aye. Any opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Meeting is adjourned.